Welcome all of you to this live program about three principles. Today our guest of honor is Professor Olga Savido from Athens, Greece. Dr. Savido is a professor of orthopedics at the first department of orthopedics in National and Kapodistrian University of Athens in Greece. Her education and training involves several centers, including the Royal National Orthopedic Hospital, the Pulvertoft Hand Center, the Mayo Clinic in Rochester, and the Hospital for Special Surgery. She's a reviewer for 8 international journals and examiner for the EPOD exam. And she's a member of the EFORT Committee for Visiting Fellowship Program. She's been the General Secretary of the Hellenic Society of Surgery HAND for 2020 and 21, and is also the Vice President, the Research Section of the Hellenic Association of Orthopedics and Traumatology. She's an invited speaker in several national and international meetings, including symposia, posters, and presentations. She has several publications in international journals and has many book chapters to her credit. So today is my great honor to introduce you to Professor Olga Savido from Athens, Greece. Over to you, Professor.
Hello. Thank you very much for the invitation, Professor Copeland. And my lecture today is about the fracture of the distal humerus, the supra and intracondylar fracture, current concept and controversies. So distal humerus fracture are relatively uncommon, about only 200% of all other fractures, 1 out of 3 of all humerus fractures. And just to remind you that about 96% have a complex pattern. And just to remind you also that there is old age group who has osteoporosis who sustain this distal humerus fracture. And the treatment is demanding. Open reduction and internal fixation is the optimal treatment. Total elbow arthroplasty, it's an alternative surgical option for elderly, and it's very essential to have a preoperative planning based on fracture type and degree of comminution. As an orthopedic surgeon, we all know that the main goal after open reduction and internal fixation is a stable fixation during the operation to cause an immediate range of motion postoperative. Sometimes, if we have an elderly patient with low demand, we can offer a non-operative treatment, the bag of bones, as the literature say, with quite a good optional results in elderly patients. Just a little word of anatomy. We have this concept of Jupiter, the column concept, and we talk about the lateral column, and we talk about the capitellum. We talk about the medial column, and we mean the medial epicondyle, and we have this trochlear capitellum articular forms, a tie arch. These tie arch must be restored in all our treatment. Restoration of the width of the distal articular surface is very essential when we treat this distal humerus fracture. And a little more words about the anatomy, just to remind you that the joint surface and the shaft axis is about 4 to 8 degrees of valgus. This is the carry angle. The articular surface segment forward from the line of the shaft of about 40 degrees. Also, the medial epicondyle is on the project axis of the shaft, and the lateral epicondyle is slightly forward from the axis. The classification, we have the Orthopedic Trauma Association and the AO classification. However, important features do not address. And which are these important features in this classification? They don't mention about the closeness of the fracture line from the joint surface. They don't mention the coronal spread fracture. And also this is the important prognostic implication about this classification. And there are quite a lot of controversy about the treatment of this distal humerus fracture, which the treatment is quite difficult. The question is about the ideal, which is the ideal surgical approach. Second question is the placement of the plates, the role of ulnar nerve transposition, prophylaxis for the epitopic ossification, And also if we can use total elbow arthroplasty for comminuted fracture in elderly, and there is still a question about the long-term results of total elbow arthroplasty in this group of patients. Let's start from the surgical approach. Which is the ideal surgical approach? Unfortunately, the answer is not, the question is not answered yet. There is no surgical approach to distal humerus fracture that is perfect. We always must do a posterior midline incision. We always must develop full thickness fasciocutaneous flaps, but the ideal surgical approach is not at the table. We, quite a lot of us use the olecranon osteotomy. Quite a lot of us use the tricep sparing approach, the paratricipital approach, the triceps splitting approach, the triceps reflecting, this is the Brian Morey approach, and also the triceps reflecting aconeus pedicle, the trap approach. And what about the approaches? And as you can see in this image, and the percentage of articular surface visible, it looks that if we do an olecranon osteotomy, as you can see here, about 57% of articular surface can be seen. When you use a tricep splitting approach, only about 35%. And when we use this triceps spurring approach, the paratriceps, about 46% of the articular surface can be seen. And as you can see here from this excellent manuscript, you can see photographs of the lower part of the forehumeral after disarticulation of the elbow, revealing the articular surface exposed by the approach. And you can see here that when you use the olecranon osteotomy, you can use most of the part of the articular surface. As I say, the most commonly used approach is the olecranon osteotomy. And after the fixation of the distal humerus fracture, we must fix the olecranon osteotomy either with a plate or with an intramedullary screw or a tension bud construct. However, we can see non-union of the osteotomy site, and there is a quite a lot of percentage of symptomatic hardware that we must excise with a second operation, and the percentage about 13%. In this diagram, we can see the triceps off approach that we can see, and we can see that all this approach, there is quite suitable for total elbow arthroplasty. However, the tendon triceps needs to be repaired back to the olecranon at the end of the repair, and the disadvantage of this approach is the prolonged rehabilitation, change of triceps weaken, or failure of the repair. What about the triceps reflecting approach, the Brian Morey approach? Is this approach better? However, in this approach we dissect subperiostally and the triceps is elevated from the medial to lateral side. There is less scar formation, less blood loss, less trauma to the triceps muscle. However, triceps weakness may be caused, and there is suboptimal visualization of the fracture. What about the triceps splitting approach? Question is better than the osteotomy. Triceps splitting approach is easy to perform. However, it offers limited articular exposure. It avoids, of course, the complication of union of the osteotomy site and can convert it to exposure necessary for total elbow arthroplasty or even olecranon osteotomy. However, this triceps splitting approach leads to devascularization and induced tricep rupture and may increase adhesion formation. And what about the paratricipital approach? It's another approach we can use to fix distal humerus fracture. However, as I already said, there is limited exposure to the distal humerus surface of the humerus. And also we can use this paratricipital approach mostly in supracodular fracture. And of course, the disadvantage of this approach is that it can easily convert it to olecranon osteotomy approach, and we can make a total elbow arthroplasty if we have an elderly patient and we can decide to do a total elbow arthroplasty. There is little evidence in the literature to support the use of one approach over the other. Let's move to the anterior transposition of the ulnar nerve. How we can handle the ulnar nerve when we want to fix a distal humerus fracture? And we can see here from the literature that is about the incidence of ulnar neuropathy is about 12%. The most important thing intraoperative is to identify the ulnar nerve, and there is insufficient evidence to support the routine ulnar nerve transposition in all distal humerus fracture fixation. However, it appears to be beneficial to those who have preoperative symptoms, to those patients who have preoperative symptoms of olecranon, of ulnar neuritis. And if we can see intraoperative, there is a direct contact of the ulnar nerve with the medial plate. So it's very important the carefully preoperative examination of the patient. And also it's very important the meticulous nerve dissection to minimize disruption of its vascular supply. And there is this ongoing a clinical trial, a multicenter randomized trial of single decompressor versus anterior transposition of the ulnar nerve when we treat acute displaced fracture of the distal humerus with a plate fixation. So there is ongoing debate and there is no consensus about the ulnar nerve transposition. The third controversy about the treating of this distal humerus fracture is the precontour anatomic locking plate and what is the plate configuration. We all agree nowadays after the O'Driscoll manuscript and all this research that in this distal humerus fracture, we must use a precontour anatomic locking plate and two plates, not only that one plate is insufficient. However, there is ongoing controversy about parallel plate or orthogonal plate. A posterior plate will confer less resistance to varus forces than would the parallel plate technique, as O'Driscoll say. Also, the orthogonal plate permit only one or two short screw for fixation. And just to remind you that the majority of the blood supply to the lateral column is derived from the posterior segmental vessels. And what about the techniques? We all agree that articular fracture and the fragment are reduced and provisional fixed with key wire. And the definite fixation of intra-articular part is done with cannulate cancellous, small cannulate cancellous screws. Care must be taken not to narrow the trochlea with a lap screw if there is a bone loss. And once intra-articular part is fixed, then intercondylar fracture is converted into a supracondylar fracture. This provisional fix with key wires and converted with definite fixation with plate contact. Fixation stability and motion arc were assessed prior to closure. All these steps, intraoperative steps, are described very well and in details based on O'Driscoll technique. So we must fix an ankle structure. We must insert every screw in the distal fragment should end in the fragment on the opposite side. So we must make the fixed angle structure. As many screws as possible, as long a screw as possible, and plates should be strong enough, as I said, anatomic precontour locking plate, and Plate should be applied with compression at the supracodular area, if this is the area where the non-union most common happen. And there is, as I said, ongoing literature debate about the position of this plate, and it seems that parallel plates are superior biomechanical compared to orthogonal plates. And this is the meta-analysis that showed that the parallel construct provide greater axial stiffness, axial strength, and torsional stiffness compared with orthogonal plate for distal humerus fixation. We move on to the use of indomethacin for prophylaxis after open reduction and internal fixation for this difficult distal humerus fracture. And as you can see here, ectorotopic ossification, it's about, the incidence is quite high. It's about 0 to 49%, with a mean about 9%. We don't usually recommend routinely prophylaxis, but we recommend prophylaxis in patients with risk factor. And which are these risk factors? It's a concomitant hand and injury, the use of bone graft or substitute intraoperative, extended postoperative immobilization, and some studies found that a delay in treatment of more than 48 hours, or in some study of even more than 24 hours, so after one day, increase the rate of heterotopic ossification about 33%. However, if we can see heterotopic ossification, most of the time heterotopic ossification doesn't cause any functional deficit, and resection is not always necessary. However, in some cases, when heterotopic ossification causes limitation, we must excise this and we must use this intromethacin for high risk patients. And however, we have this enormous development of plates and this anatomic pre-contour plate for distal humerus fracture. And we have all this lecture and all this manuscript about the surgical technique. However, complication is quite difficult fracture, this distal humerus fracture, especially in elderly patients. And we have quite a common complication. The rate of complication are quite high. We talk about mechanical failure. We talk about ulnar neuropathy, about stiffness, heterotopic ossification, non-union, malunion, infection, and complication from olecranon osteotomy, which is the most common use approach for treating this distal humerus fracture. And I will show some examples of unsuccessful fixation. And as you can see here, this is an inadequate fixation of the distal humerus fracture in a 46-year-old female. And you can see here the non-union, but it's not because of the fracture, because we are not strict with the operative techniques. This screw is very insufficient, and this fixation is inadequate for a stable fixation of this distal humerus fracture. Or this is a non-union or even non-union when we don't use the appropriate plates and the appropriate technique. Or even we can have this postoperative radiograph of a distal humerus fracture. And as we can see here, the orthopedic surgeon used this 1/3 tibular plate or this reconstruction plate with this is free screw. And this patient not only has a non-union, but has an infected non-union. So we must always have in our mind that when we have a non-union, even if there is no obvious clinical signs, we must always take deep culture because the infection may be a cause of this non-union of this distal humerus fracture. as in this open fracture gustilo 3B in a female of 52 years old. And as in this case, and you can see here, this is a supra-intracontular fracture of the distal humerus. However, if you can see here in these radiographs, you can see postoperative radiographs, you can see here that this plate in the medial side is quite strong, so our construct is not so strong to support the immediate mobilization postoperative. And we have this non-union in the supracondylar area, which is the most common area of non-union that happens. Or even in this case, a non-union, another non-union in the supracondylar area, or even in this case, and you can see, we have also, if we use an osteotomy, the olecranon osteotomy, we can have a non-union of the our olecranon osteotomy. So we must stick to our technique till the end, till the fixation of the olecranon osteotomy. This is another comminute fracture of the distal humerus in a 53 years old female. And as you can see here, the orthopedic surgeon use 1/3 tibular plate. These are not the appropriate plate for this distal humerus fracture. And there was a non-union, a second operation, and this is the post-operative radiographs. So you can see here the synov. We use this pre-contour plate with a rheo-reef, the fracture, and we use bone graft with a quite a successful post-operative radiographs after the second operation and quite good range of motion of the patient. So we must, if we decide to use a distal plate fixation for distal humerus fracture, we must be very careful and very strict to our operative technique. And our last question is, what about the total elbow arthroplasty? Can we use total elbow arthroplasty if you have a comminute fracture of the distal humerus fracture in elderly patient, in patient more than 65 years old? And if we have high comminute type C fracture basal on with low bone quality due to osteoporosis? And the answer is also a debate in the literature. However, a total elbow arthroplasty is often considered to be a better choice compared to open reduction and internal fixation of this distal humerus fracture with, when we have, as I said, high comminute fracture in old patients more than 65 years old with low bone quality due to osteoporosis. However, the evidence for patient selection, complication, and functional results is contradictory. And in younger patients, however, every effort should still be made to preserve the native joint as their life expectancy outlasts the implant longevity. So when we have young patients, we prefer to open reduction and internal fixation than to put a total elbow arthroplasty. And this is a very nice manuscript of Raul Barco about the total elbow arthroplasty for distal humerus fracture. And I can say that there is an enthusiasm of using total elbow arthroplasty for this comminute distal elbow fracture. But nowadays there is a skepticism, and the long term results are quite controversy. This is a very nice paper of Raul Barco regarding the total elbow arthroplasty in this difficult group of patients. And they search the short-term outcomes and the long-term outcomes of this group of patients. They study 44 total elbow arthroplasty after distal humerus fracture with a minimum follow-up of 10 years. This is a quite long follow-up, And the author evaluates the pain, the range of motion, and also the scores, the complication, and the reoperation rate in this group of patients. And they conclude, the authors conclude, that selective use of total elbow arthroplasty to treat this fracture for less active older patients and patients with inflammatory arthritis has acceptable longevity in surviving patients, but at the cost of a number of major complications. So there is a controversy about the use of total elbow arthroplasty even nowadays. Total elbow arthroplasty has its own limitation and complication, which may be underestimated in study without long-term follow-up. And just to remind you, the restriction of lifting of no more than 5 pounds means about 5 kilos is a considerable restriction in this patient. Just to remind you, the implant loosening, which is quite common in total elbow arthroplasty, and also the increased risk of periprosthetic fractures requiring revision arthroplasty, it's quite high. A recent study on fixation of intraradicular distal fracture in elderly have reported improved results using plates fixation. And this is an image, this is a diagram of many reports regarding a manuscript regarding fracture of the distal humerus using plates in parallel or orthogonal configuration with quite good results and with a long-term follow-up. And my last proposal, my last question is, what about to use a distal humerus, not arthroplasty, but hemiarthroplasty? Consider over the longevity of total elbow arthroplasty in younger, more active patients lead to introduction of distal humerus hemiarthroplasty, may require fewer physical restriction than total elbow arthroplasty. However, medium-term outcomes is limited and is not currently approved by the FDA. However, we can see its use and its results, long-term results of distal humerus hemiarthroplasty in the future. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor. Prof, you can stop sharing.
Yes. Just a moment. Stop sharing. Yes.
Yeah.
Okay.
Thank you, Professor, for this detailed presentation. And let's have a short question answer session. Professor, you mentioned so many approaches, the triceps splitting, triceps reflecting, the trap approach, the olecranon and osteotomy. So what is your preferred approach in your hospital? What do you, which one do you prefer?
Okay. When we have a distal humerus fracture, the most common approach we use is the olecranon osteotomy. But when we have, because in all fracture, when there is comminution, all the patient underwent a CT of the elbow. When there is a suspicion that in all patients with a comminution, we maybe use a total elbow arthroplasty, as I said, the olecranon osteotomy is not a preferred approach, so we use the paratricipital approach.
Thank you, Professor. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And in case you do an olecranon osteotomy, what is your preferred approach to fix it back? For example, is it a screw, using K wires or plates?
Some of us, of our department, in our department, use a screw, a cannulate screw. Most of us use a tension bar technique.
Use a plate?
No, because they use the Chevron technique.
Chevron,
and
yeah.
We prefer to make a tension bar technique.
tension band, because lock is a lot of surgeons use the locking plate as well, right? So do you think that's a good idea? Because but the problem is time. Again, you're spending so much of time on fixing the ulcerative osteotomy, isn't it?
Yes. And not only that, there is a manuscript regarding the tension bar techniques, because all orthopedic believes that tension bar is a very easy approach. It's a very easy technique. But think about the fixed distal humerus fracture, a comminute fracture, how many hours it can take. And after all, you have to fix also the olecranon osteotomy. And there is a manuscript regarding about, if I remember where, about 9 steps that you can make wrong when you fix an olecranon osteotomy with a tension bar.
Great. Thank you so much for that. And Professor Olga, what about hemiarthroplasty versus total elbow? What is your approach? Do you prefer that in your hospital for these elderly patients?
Actually, we don't have distal humerus hemiarthroplasty in our department. I think in Greece, we don't have distal humerus hemiarthroplasty. However, there is quite a lot, an enormous literature in Europe, in Scandinavian countries. In Copenhagen, they use the distal humerus hemiarthroplasty, and the results are quite satisfactory. The only thing about the distal humerus hemiarthroplasty is that you must have an elbow that is stable. So you must have all the ligament, the medial and the lateral ligament, intact.
And what about total elbows, total elbow arthroplasty in your hospital for these elderly patients?
Okay, we use the implant cast total elbow arthroplasty. It's a hinge arthroplasty, and we use it in elderly patients with this restriction. We are not very fond of using a total elbow arthroplasty. And as I said, the 65 years old, it's not a number. You always must see the biological age of the patient, because sometimes 65 years old, it's a quite young patient with very active, with high activity, a lot of sport. So you must balance not only the age, but to see the biological and the needs of activity of the patient. So in this case, when we have even a 65 years old male or female, quite active, we are very skeptical about using a total elbow arthroplasty, and we must try to fix the fracture, if possible, of course.
Thank you, Professor. Just one last question before wind up. Suppose you have 10 elderly patients with distal humeral fractures. How many of them would you fix it, and how many of you would you replace? Just an approximate percentage in your hospital.
About, let's say, 10% only replace, and about 90% fix it. Fix it with pre-contour plate in orthogonal or parallel type. Depends from the fracture.
Thank you, Professor. Prof, I think that's all the questions that we have for this session. Thank you for this wonderful presentation, and really look forward for more from your side.
Okay. Thank you very much for the invitation.